Лукас Апа из EO Active представит свой доклад «Hacking Robots for Skynet». Вот, надеюсь, всем все понравится.
Okay, thank you for coming, for waiting. My name is Lucas Apa, and I'm from Argentina. This is the first time I come to Russia, so I'm super, super excited. I'm gonna stay here for 1 month. So if you wanna hang out with me afterwards, come and we have some beer, some vodka. So my talk, I did this talk with Cesar Cerrudo from Argentina as well. And we started researching robots. Why? Because we started to see like many marketing material on internet, on news, you know, that they were promoting this technology as being like really amazing and doing a lot of amazing stuff in videos. So we started wondering, okay, is this something that they have to meet the expectations of people? Because people always dream of robots. Like, since we were born, we always have the concept of robots being something technological and something new. So everyone wants robots. So, but that pressure that people does, and we were thinking, okay, maybe companies, they are starting to do messy with the technical, with the security part of their products. So that's why we started to see, okay, let's try to analyze which are the modern robots companies and which are the main manufacturers in the world to try to see if they are secure, how attackers can leverage this in order to cause a different kind of harm. No? And first we discovered that there are many like ecosystems, many different technologies that interact with robots. It's not like in IoT that maybe it's just one device and maybe it connects to the network or connects to some other social network and that's it. Robots have more like integral vision. So they connect to mobile applications, they connect to web applications. So that's why we were so interested in seeing how these robots are adopted by society. Right now, we found and we tried to... And we realized that there were many accidents of the medical robots and military robots. But we were wondering, okay, what could happen with the other robots, the one that doesn't have like guns or explosives? Well, what kind of harm an attacker can do right now? And also we wanted to see technology that is not mainstream yet. So it's not that we see robots everywhere right now. It's something that we still have like maybe 3 or 4 years to start seeing robots everywhere. Maybe in other countries it's more common, like for example in Japan, you go to stores and you see robots. Maybe here in Russia I haven't seen, but still there are many. So first we try to analyze, okay, which are the home robots and business robots that we can actually audit, the ones that we could get a firmware online, that we could get mobile applications, or maybe that we could have access to buy them. So we choose these robots. These are like business robots, business oriented and home. The business ones, they are mostly used with in airport, hospitals, and for many purposes, like interacting with people. They are very big, as you can see, like 1.3 meters. And the other ones are more like house robots. It's more like personal assistants. It's more like an Alexa with arms and legs. And we analyzed these robots. We were able to get all the firmware, so we reverse engineered these ones. And we chose like Nao and Pepper, which is from a company from Japan, very famous, one of the most famous and most sold robot in the world, 20,000 robots around. And it has like a lot of funding. So it's SoftBank recently purchased Dynamics. So they are doing like robotics they are very into robotics and they are doing a lot of work in that. And then we chose like more research robots. Like we all always know that research projects, they don't have much security. And actually they didn't put any kind of security, but it's something understandable because they need flexibility. When they do research, they don't put security on purpose because they need something flexible they need to access. So The technology behind this is basically just computers. Some robots have two different computers, so for example, a tablet and then a computer inside. As you can see there, the processors, just like a normal computer with different entry points, maybe Ethernet, Wi-Fi, or Bluetooth, the different connectivity that they have. But most of them run Linux, like ARM, like you can see that one from UVTech. This is like, there are many, many in China of these ones. It's one of the most accessible. Even they are like $2,000. We bought those two. It was $2,000 near, and this one was 10,000. And we only bought it just to do some demos, but to do the entire research, we were able to do it just with the firmware. Just with the firmware and understanding how it works, it was possible. So the way, and another kind of robots that we wanted to explore is the industrial collaborative, which are different than the ones that maybe we are used to, like in to make cars, for example. These ones, they work back to back with humans. So when humans, they stay very, very close to these robots. They grab objects, they give it to these mechanical arms. Sorry, I will close this because I get confused. So as you can see there, you see the different industrial collaborative robots that basically is like arms and then a computer that has like the control unit. And we decided to use these ones to analyze the American one called Baxter and Sawyer and from Universal Robots, also very, very widely used. Maybe like 10,000 robots are in many factories around the world. So the difference is that these ones, they work back to back with persons. So we wanted to explore, okay, what could happen if someone can disable the safety features that the robot have to protect from hurting humans. So as you can see there are many uses that you can have this robot work with. For example, you have working with humans, and then you can, for example, these companies, they did like a robotic kitchen, because it's very precise, the way they move and very fast, and DARPA also did like a robotic arm to fly a plane. So there are infinite possibilities of doing with these collaborative robots. So we wanted to explore how is the security with these ones as well. Also, we found many companies in Japan, specifically, that they do robotics like from 30 years ago, and they have all the mechanics and everything. It's like more like the ones you can see on, I don't know, in Disney World on that. But they basically, they purchase like software from one company that makes like the bridge between the hardware and the software. So we wanted to audit these kind of controllers that many companies different use because they don't do software, but they buy from one company. So we wanted to explore, this is some robots that they actually use this kind of technology. So we are going to see some video now about the robots in action. I hope the sound is going out. This is just to get an idea of the kind of technology, to realize that this is different than IoT. And you will see why, because they move, they have arms. Can we put the audio? Do like this. Wait. Let's do it. Just. Now that we have an idea of how they look like, we can go talk about how was the approach that we that the research approach that we had. So basically we did. I'm gonna explain later how we did it, but the results of our research was we found nearly 50 vulnerabilities on the different companies and different robots. We found a lot of critical issues, many critical issues that we were able to control the robot remotely by or exploiting vulnerabilities or by just very bad security. No, so as you can see there, Pepper, you are the different robots. So we found, but it's not that we spend too much time as well, like reverse engineering the robots. We just went through the most critical issues that we could find, and we just went right there. So what we found when doing like the firmware analysis that we started downloading, what we did was basically download all the firmware images that we were able to find, all the mobile applications, and also the documentation, the SDK. And we found that many of these robots, they provide, as well as the firmware image of the robot, they provide a virtual machine. So this is something common because they want you to, for example, to develop applications, to develop different software. So they provide you this environment. So the best way of having like a functional robot on your home is to merge these two virtual machines. For example, we have the virtual machine of the robot and then the firmware image. So we copied the main binaries to the virtual machine, and then we try to make it work, like mounting, like changing, for example, the dynamic links of the binary of the binaries. So it was possible to, for example, to execute some software from the robot inside the virtual machine, and this helped us for doing like dynamic analysis. Because with just the firmware alone, we can just do like more reverse static approach. But this way, we could actually turn up some services and then to actually try, no? To actually see if our exploits work. As you can see, for example, for Pepper, one of the white robots, the big one, we mounted different partitions, and then we had to copy some files into a virtual machine, and that's it. And this is something very common. Like we found on other, for example, that we merged different binaries from the universal robots as well, that we had a virtual machine, and then we found the binaries as well. So we merged them. This way we did it, like we converted into a virtual box image, one of the main firmware images, and then we merge it with the default VM that they give you just for development. So we use some QEMU as well to emulate some stuff, but still it was more using like mount. It wasn't hard actually to extract all these binaries from this file. So anyone can do it. As you can see there, some. And also we use chroot as well to change the root folder of our commands, so it was much easier. So when you see robots, for example, they are connected in a hospital or in an airport, how can an attacker know where the robot is, what's the IP address of the robot? One way is just asking the robot, because some robots, for example, there is one white that you say, what's your IP address, and the robot tells you. But for other ones, most of them use multicast DNS. So they advertise their presence on the network. So it's very easy just to do ping, and then now.local, or for example, the name of the robot, and you for sure we will find it. So for, as you can see, universal robots as well, you can use this MDNS name. So it's easy. So also, these kind of robots are very exposed to the people. It's not that they are inside the like data center. So it's something that they are connected to the local network of the place they are working. We have seen some people told us that in some banks they were using one of the robots and they had it connected to the backend. The robots connected to the backend because they need the customers to, for example, to search for information using the robot. So we found many authentication and authorization vulnerabilities. And this was basically through Wi-Fi, Bluetooth, and Ethernet. We found many different services. And the main reason for this is that, they start usually as research projects, and then they move out to production. And we saw, for example, many ports. It was able, if you understand the protocol, sometimes the protocol is public and sometimes it's not. But if you understand it, you can move just the joints of the robot. And robots are big, so you can actually cause harm. We will see later. But as you can see, there are many different robots that they have authentication problems. So, but some of them, they don't have authentication at all. And other ones, they have authentication, but we were able to bypass it very easy. As you can see, with this robot, it's one of the most used in Japan and now in the United States. They have like an Nginx file that they only had like authentication module for just that regular expression that is just one JavaScript file. So if you are able to get this JavaScript file from the firmware of the robot, you can just put it locally on your browser. And then when you are asking for the different resources of the web application for the web console of the robot, you can just, you get, for example, they ask you for username and password for just this JavaScript file. But you can put it locally on the browser, and that's it. So we have other examples of authentication problems. We were able to understand the protocol and then enter and install new actions on the robots. We will see a demo. This was the way we did this was to do a man in the middle between the application and then the robot, and then understand the packets and then change it.
And a handyman.
All right, I got the flange off.
I have to explain that this is like the official video of the promotional video of the robot. So they encourage you to put screwdrivers in the robot hands.
And a handyman.
All right, I got the flange off. What's next, Alpha?
Step 4, use a small screwdriver to attach the adapter flange.
Thanks, Alpha.
So as you can see, you can use robots for causing harm. In this case, it's very small, it's very weak, but the trend is that they are going to be stronger and faster. So the idea is that the promotional video doesn't help too much, that they promote actually to do it. So the robots can be used as we saw, like more like a human threat. We can use the robot as an espionage possibility because they have cameras and very, like high definition cameras, the directional microphones on their heads. And also everyone trusts the robot. For example, there are some robots that they are meant to be used in the office. So they can actually read the map of the office and move around the entire office. So everyone trusts this little pet, no? That they come over, but the problem is that if someone hacks it, they can get a lot of trade secrets from that because of the cameras and the facial recognition as well. Because some of the robots, like I think two or three that we analyzed, they have facial recognition features. So they build like an internal database. So, but as an attacker, we were able to, for example, to access these modules and use it as a post-exploitation strategy, no? Because they are like they are meant to be used for the programmers, but also they can leverage by attackers. So for example, for this robot, we found that they load many different modules. For example, the AL video, AL audio, and different like C modules. And there was also, we found that there was a module called proxy. So from outside, from TCP, if you have connectivity to the robot, this is something very important because you need at least or access to Wi-Fi or access Ethernet. But Ethernet is with this kind of robot is impossible, but with Wi-Fi it's very common that they are connected. So we basically found that there are many models on these robots, and through the IAL proxy, as you can see on the top, AL proxy, we can access to other models, like for example AL video or AL motion. And with this, it's very easy to just control the head of the robot and then spy, for example. We can see a video. I don't know if it is embedded. But well, the basic idea of the video, I don't know if it is there, but the main idea is that we enter into the robot head, and then we can move it. We can move the joints, and then we can capture video live. This is one of the robots that we bought. We sent it to Argentina, and we were doing some tests. So then we found like more privacy problems. Why? Because one of these robots, we found that they were sending a lot of information to some servers that they were from the vendor. That like GPS coordinates, like photos. So all the photos that this robot take, they send it automatically to their servers. They send like telephony data. I think the time, because I started later, so maybe time is different. Yeah, like 20 minutes later or something. Yeah. Okay. And also they recognize all the voice commands, and they send on the same network. They send it in plain text. We didn't understand why was that. Maybe like a debug issue or that they forgot to turn off. But we were realizing that all the voice that we were speaking when the robot was near was sent as text inside the network. And also these robots can be controlled from the cloud. And that's, we will see later what are the consequences of this. Also, this company, they raised an Indiegogo campaign to convince people to fund their project. And they say that they truly believe that customer privacy is sacred. They work hard to protect information and that. So evidently, they don't work very hard because everything was transmitted in clear text. And also, they said, how secure is this? Alpha 2 uses MySQL encryption to secure personal data sent to and from the cloud. We don't know how they do this, actually, using MySQL encryption. But this is the way that sometimes they use to convince people, using like technical words. In campaigns. So we found also that some robots, they use OAuth tokens. They use it, for example, to access social media, to access to like the vendors' services, because robots have like app stores. They have different like web applications that they connect. So in order, for example, for this robot particular, there was a function that we found while reverse engineering one of the classes, the all cloud token. We found this get access token. So we were wondering why it was exposed this. No? And we realized that the tablet that is on the chest was communicating with like the head of the robot all the time. So this is like two components from the robot that communicate in order to pass like the secrets, no? So we found that it was possible to just having the SDK to call this function, like we instantiate like the al proxy, and then we use this undocumented function get access token, and we were able to get all the tokens installed on the robot and decrypt it with the key that we found on the tablet. So this is also important to analyze like communication between the same robot, especially because they are two computers. And then on the other side, we try to explore, okay, how can human be endangered with this? So we found that robots actually have two different kind of ways of preventing hurting. Like one is self-collision sensors, so they prevent hurting itself. And then external collisions, which they are meant to protect from hurting people, like moving fast and killing someone. So in order, for example, as you can see in the picture, there are many Chinese workers work very close with the robot. This is in China, and it's 64 robots around in the same factory. So the main idea is, okay, how can these robots actually hurt someone? And there were research that, yeah, they say that if they move enough, like fast, they can cause like a skull fracture if they hit you in the head. So they are very strong. That's why we wanted to analyze these kind of robots as well, because they are the stronger ones. But maybe in the future we have like more equality in the force, like the business and home and the industrial ones. So we found that there is a special kind of companies that they install the robot, and they are called integrators. So they are the ones that they decide which are the safety settings. And by safety settings, I mean limiting force of the robot, the momentum, the speed, or putting, like, as you can see there, like sensors. Like a sensor that when a person is approaching the robot, it automatically slows down. So this company is the only one that can manipulate this, and they give you the robot, they install it, and then if you are the owner, you cannot change it. So this kind of safety settings are put in place, but these kind of figures, integrators. And then you can see like safety planes as well. They can put like 3D planes on the right, and then you can see like the robot never crosses this part because maybe there is a worker there. Like for example, in the Chinese picture that we saw, probably they had like many safety planes in order to avoid hurting to a robot, because the robot calculates the trajectory on its own. So it's important to have safety planes. So for attacking this robot, in order to say, okay, let's disable these features remotely, we exploited 5 different vulnerabilities. The first one was like a version disclosure issue that basically we use the path. 10 minutes, okay. What time is it? Maybe. Okay, for this exploit, we have more information in our blog post. I will do it more like high level, so I can cover more content. But basically, we exploited in one of the ports of the robot. We found that if we ask for a different installation, like load installation, this not exist, we were able to get the path. And then we use this for the buffer overflow exploit. So we exploit the stack-based buffer overflow in one of the services of the robot. Of course, you have to have network connectivity to the robot. It's not that you can do it on Wi-Fi, no? But still, these robots are meant to be connected with computers, because computers can submit like actions or tasks on real time. Like, for example, if a box is arriving, he can notify the robot. So we found that on the Modbus TCP request protocol, there were some bytes that were controlled by the attacker and could manipulate this receive function and the length of this copy. No? So we were able to write content into the memory. So in order to exploit this, I will go very fast, but we had to, in order to get a shell remotely, we were calling the exec VE system call, and we had to prepare, like in memory, different strings and different pointers. And the way we did this was basically, this is like the pseudo code of the exec code of the line that will execute and will connect to our IP address. It's like a reverse shell, but the thing is that the binary was running with NX, and the system was ASLR. VA randomize 1. So we had to do like a remote exploit using ROP, basically. So we did like, this is like the stack layout. We had like stage 1, stage 2. We have different ROP addresses in between and the Modbus header. So the stage 1, basically what we did, I will go very fast, but it's a shame, but still what we did was to put in memory different strings. And since we weren't able to put zeros on these strings, on runtime, we calculate where these strings were, and then we copied some zeros, and then we updated the pointer list of where are these strings in memory. So we did this basically to be able to at the end, on the stage 2, to prepare the execve call, and then call the interrupt gadget, and then just get a shell. No? So once we get a shell, we modify safety settings of the robot. So it was possible. We were like root, and we were able to change these limits. And this is because they had no integrity mechanism. They only had like a checksum a checksum calculation on this file, but it was very easy to bypass it because it was just 2 bytes. So if you change, for example, some floating points numbers, like at the end, you can change some decimals, you can brute force it until you get the same checksum as before. So you can modify these files. And also you can restart the robot in a very fast way so nobody will understand, will realize. I will skip this. And then we use another port for the robot in order to move it randomly. So we use the 30,000 port, and then we command the robot to move it very fast and very quickly. We will see like a video. This is a very quick video. You can see there how it stops because it detected a person. It automatically stops, and then you can see that the safety limits are read-only, so nobody can change this. Like, for example, the force, the power, the speed, the momentum. And this is something that the integrators put. And they put like boundaries or limit the joints, which is the maximum angle that they can move. So this is the main problem with this is that all these safety features are coded in the same operating system than the robot. So it's very easy to, if there is no isolation, it's very easy to enter and then to disable this mechanism. And this, I think, will be like the problem of the future, because it will be very hard to make an isolated component that protects actually the human from the hardware, from someone to change how the hardware decides if it's gonna hit someone or not. As you can see there, this is the remote exploit that has 150 gadgets. This restarts the robot and then change the safety configuration. But as I said, the main issue with this is that currently robots cannot provide enough safety. Because of this, because if you can hack it, and like for example with other business robots, we found the same like safety settings to protect from hitting someone, but it was possible, like in Pepper, in Baxter as well, it was possible to disable it. So we were able to exploit the remote buffer overflow and then change remotely, like disable boundaries and disable like emergency buttons. For example, if there is a button, you press it and it doesn't do anything. So it was possible to disable this. And by this, the attacker can also send to the robot violent moves. So he can actually hurt someone. I'm very hard. Now, this is a simulator that the company provides because the robot was very expensive. But yes, but the binary was exactly the same. The binary, because we injected it and we verified that it was exactly the same. So the main idea behind this is that other robots, they have the same problems. Like, it was possible to disable some of them because of it was for research, so they allow you to disable this. And the other ones, like, for example, Pepper, they require user consent for disabling this. But with the authentication bypass that we showed before, it was possible to disable this. So you can actually kick someone or punch someone in the face with the robot. As you can see there, security protection can be disabled. We found like many research frameworks. Like the most important one is ROS. This is widely used, but they don't have any security. That's very sad. But the problem is that this kind of frameworks is used for more for research purposes and not for being out there in the business. But the issue is that there are many companies. Like for example, Dubai Police is right now bought a robot from REEM. And they actually use this robot. They modify it. But they use this research framework on the bottom. So at the very core of the robot, they don't have security. Maybe they put some other thing. But there are many companies that they rely on this. Also, we found many physical attacks because robots are everywhere in the stores and they are in contact with people. So we found like USB. That you can put a keyword, you can install malware, you can connect to the internet ports. This is like one version from the Dubai robot as well. We found like physical attacks against like insecure storage as well, like memory cards and that. We found, for example, the Wi-Fi password. If you remove the memory card from the robot, you can get the Wi-Fi password. So you can get a lot of information. And the main problem here as well is that how much these companies can control your robot. Because some companies, for example, this one from Bizido, they have like your private key to your robot. So when you connect to your robot, it sends your key to move the robot to the servers. So in the future, what could happen if these companies, they can actually control your robot from home? Or maybe if someone hacks these companies, right? Like they can get like an army of multiple robots like you see in the background. So we found like a lot of firmware upgrade problems. We were able to change the robot remotely. We were able to kill the robot as well because it's very hard to send the robot back to the factory because of customs, because of they are big. We had to send it to the United States because we had one arm broken. And it was very expensive. We had unsigned updates, problems in different robots as well, that they didn't verify the integrity. So basically, we found many problems. We are releasing a technical paper with more details about each of these. We wanted to give a general overview of what are the problems that we found. And if you are interested later, you can read all the technical details. But the main idea is that we found insecure communications. We found many problems that we already know about. The main issue is that the consequences are different because robots have arms and legs and they are getting bigger. So I think many companies in the future, many like bounties, many bug bounties will be interested in this kind of technology. Right now, it's not very mainstream, so we still have time. So the consequences, as I told you, very privacy issues, human can actually get attacked, and espionage, no? And companies can get like property damage, and also they can get like information stolen because they can see, you can use the robot to see, to hear. And also on the military side, they have like weapons, they have explosives. So the consequences, we already know what could happen, no? The responses from the vendors weren't very good, actually. They said that the findings were interesting. It was something that they should do about, but they didn't do much. One of the companies, they couldn't fix the issues. And the other ones, they say that they encourage developers to code responsibly, but they discourage inappropriate robot behavior, as if the robot was behaving bad and you should punish it, you know, if he's behaving wrong. So the way to improve the robot cybersecurity is to improve the way you can factory reset the robots and also securing the supply chain. Well, there are many techniques, but basically to invest less in marketing. As we saw in the videos on the first part, you see a lot of amazing videos and things that the robot can do, but maybe some of them, they are not possible. Like I bought the robots and it's totally lying. They are totally lying. So invest less in marketing, more in security, as you know. And as I show you, the current robots can't provide enough safety, like for humans, because there is no isolation in the components. There are many studies now, research, that they can, for example, put airbags on the robots, and these airbags are totally independent from the CPU of the robot. This is like one good solution. Maybe there are more in the future. I haven't researched this, but this is something we should fix together. As soon as possible. Thank you very much. I will be here for 1 month. Thank you. I will be here for 1 month, so if you want to have vodka with me, thank you.